Okay, guys, I got a good question for you this week. What is the scariest amusement park ride that you've ever been on, and why? Starting with DeHart.
You can start with me. I have a fucking list of fucking. There are reasons. First of all, the most terrifying ride I've ever been on probably was Chang, because I thought I was going to die because it was compressing my fucking spinal cord. That ride was a straight up torture device. They used that ride instead of waterboarding in Korea.
I agree. That one was really fucking bad. I remember my neck just feel like it was splintering out the top of my head.
My dad came off that ride and he's like, I'm pretty sure I just slipped a disc. And I'm like, yeah, you probably did. And it was fucking bullshit. Scariest ride that I've never been on is any ride that causes you to be just free floating, and where if the fucking harness fell off, you would just fall to your death.
Oh, just like a bungee drop, basically.
Yeah. Those crazy rides, like the Superman ride, where you're you're supposed to feel like you're... Exactly.
Yeah.
You're supposed to feel like you're flying, but really, you will die if you ride this.
Well, the Firehawk even did it upside down. You were free floating, but you're upside down and backwards.
That's what I'm saying. Like, you... If your harness doesn't work, you are fucked. And I've been on plenty of rides where the harness didn't work. Plenty.
Yeah, that's a good one.
But at the same time, I've ridden rides at Harvest Homecoming, and those rides are maintained by the scum of the earth.
Oh yeah, and they
they don't give a fuck.
They cost
if you die on the ride
$13 to maintain a year.
They're like, well, that bolt's pretty much gone now. We should probably replace it. Well, it'll be in the budget for next year. Like, shit like that really happening.
Oh, yeah. What about you, DeHart?
Yeah, I've got to give it to anything at a local fair.
Just anything ran by carnies. Anything.
Well, okay, the things that are on the ground, those are generally okay. I mean, what's the hardest you're going to take a fall from... one of those things that spins around.
Yeah.
You know, merry-go-round?
Like no, it's not a merry-go-round. It's
the centrifuge thing where it, pushes you against the edge.
Okay, so like a teacup, basically.
Yeah. You obviously can't get hurt on that, or at least it's very unlikely.
It just breaks off the thing and just starts tumbling with you in it.
Well, I'm saying, with a caveat, it's a lot less likely. There's no gravity death involved.
Yeah. Okay. But the thing where you're...
Gravity death.
You're being flung out in a circle, and then being pulled back. It's like, I can completely imagine, it's like, this is not going to pull back. There's not going to be anything there.
You go out and then, you keep going out.
See ya.
You end up in the fucking Ohio River or just smashed against the rock or something.
Just smashed against, some random passerby.
Yeah.
Impaled on a
I always think of Mighty Joe Young with the runaway giant, wheel or whatever it was. Was that Mighty Joe Young?
I don't remember that movie at all.
Was this giant gorilla and I don't think they ever explained why it was giant or what the fuck the deal was, but I think at some point it tears up a huge... Is the Ferris wheel the one where it's a giant wheel and they go up and around and down?
Uh-huh.
Yeah, it was one of those, and it just tore off of its track and it was just rolling, on a path.
That happened in Sharknado.
Well, there you go. If it happened in Sharknado, it can happen in real life.
Oh.
So that's what I've always been terrified of happening. How fucking fucked would you be if you were on that ride and that happened? You would be done.
Yeah, dead. Well, most of these.
True.
But I'm going to play the asshole, and I have three different ones I have to talk about here.
Okay.
And the first two are from my childhood, and they're kind of tied because they're equally as scary. And they're both at the same fucking place. They're at this place called Wet and Wild, and that was in Florida, Orlando.
You gotta love that fucking straight up porno title name.
Yeah. So,
which one was it? Was it Wet and Wild 7? Or what?
Yeah. Well, the first one was called The Black Hole, and it was me in this room with this really huge black eye. No, I'm just kidding. But no, it was a water slide. And
Steven's just describing being molested as his worst amusement park ride.
No, you get up to the top, and it's this giant black tube, and it's gigantic. And you jump down in it, pitch black. There is nothing. You can't see anything for the entire length of the water slide. And you're going upside down in flips.
Upside down on a water
slide?
Oh,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Are you on a track?
No, it's like a tube. It's a black tube that you go into.
Is this thing a mile up? How the fuck is there a
giant
loop
in
a fucking water tube that you just slide in with water?
It's terrifying.
That just sounds irresponsible. Unresponsible.
Unresponsible.
That's impossible.
But seriously, fucking terrifying. I hated going on it, and my brother always made me go on it when I was younger.
Of course he did.
Second one, equally as fucking scary. Straight down water slide, which are already scary anyway, because you always feel like you're going to fall off the fucking thing when you go down it. You walk all the way up to this thing. This one is an indoor one, so you can't see the slide whenever you go up. You go up to this little platform, and there's this rocket ship up at the top. You stand in the rocket ship. The bottom flaps open while you're inside of it, and you fall down this water slide.
Just imagine your terror the first time, right? You just walk in, you're like, where's the ride? Ah!
Well, it's not even just the first time. It's every time, because you never know when they're going to hit the button. You never know.
That is satanic.
Right? It's fucking terrifying.
Like, I'm glad Wet n Wild is just torture devices.
Oh, no. You're not leaning in anything. You're standing in the middle of this little rocket.
Okay, so you're standing. You're not, like, in proper astronaut position where you're like, what?
No.
All right.
No, you're like, standing.
Going this way? And then you...
And then you go the opposite way.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
You stand there. They say, stand straight and put your arms to your side. Like, kind of like a bullet or whatever they say. And then they hit a button, and the flaps on the door open up to the bottom so that you can't hit them.
And then you fall into a Sarlacc pit.
Basically.
To be digested for 1,000 years.
Yes. So,
like, that fucking matters. That's one thing that I've always thought was so stupid. You would die instantly. You would suffocate within a minute.
But no, you're going to be digested for 1,000 years.
So who gives a fuck?
And feel it for those 1,000 years.
You know what? You're going to be buried in the ground and digested by worms for 1,000 years.
Oh, yeah.
Who gives a shit? You're dead.
I'm sure it's really going to hurt.
Yeah.
Okay, so that was when I was a child, but recently, in October, I went on Space Mountain for the first time since I was like 8.
Oh, fuck yes.
Woo!
Yeah, for the first time since I was like 8. The last time I went to Disney World, I didn't go on it because the fucking lines were so long. Well, me and Brittany had a fast pass, so we go there for my honeymoon. If you listen to the show, you don't know me. I'm about, 320 pounds and 6'2". So I'm a big fucking guy. And this ride
too
was
big to be riding children's rides.
Right, and this ride was made in like 1979, and there was no fat people in 1979.
Yeah, obviously.
Well, the ride was
all there were fat people, but everyone hated them.
Right, the ride was made for literally just like children and skinny people.
Right,
and I get on this ride, and I fit comfortably in it, you know, and then I look up, and I feel like the fucking ceiling of this ride is 2 inches from my head. And Brandy's sitting behind me, and she said that there was, like, 2 feet. But to me, it felt like 2 inches. So, of course...
So you just have poor death perception, and that's why the ride is scary.
I guess so, because it's an inside roller coaster. And I thought every piece of wood, every bar, everything was just going to decapitate me. Like, you look at the picture, you know, the pictures they take while you're riding?
Right. Sometimes it's kids that are like, oh no, this is scary. And sometimes it's adults that are like pretending to be scared or doing something stupid, like flipping off the camera.
I'm shitting my pants in this picture. Like, you see Brandy and she's like, yeah! And then you see me and I'm literally scrunched up with my head turning into my shoulders.
You are right now the scaredest individual at Disney World.
Oh yeah. Like, my head went down into my body like a shell. Like, that's how afraid I was.
Thank goodness you're a Ninja Turtle, right?
Yeah. Like. thank God. So, with that being said, welcome to Motion Picture Meltdown. I'm one of your hosts, Stephen the Rose Rosenberg.
Phil the Kill Collins.
And DeHart.
And the reason we brought up amusement parks is because we thought it would be kind of creepy to do a sort of amusement park podcast.
Oh, yeah,
it's
creepy.
Yeah.
It's very
murdery.
Why would we
do it?
Because amusement park, well...
Yeah, that doesn't make any sense, Stephen. We thought it might be creepy to do this. Like, our goal of the podcast, it's in our mission statement, to be great, to be entertaining, and be, above all, be extremely creepy.
We're going to creep you out in your ear holes.
Whoa.
Listen to us before bed, and you will have terrible nightmares.
How many different ways can I take that, DeHart? We're going to be creepy in your ear holes.
Yeah, all the different ways imaginable.
Yeah.
I actually, this show did give me a nightmare, like, on Saturday, because somebody had been murdered. And for some reason, like, this investigator was following me around. And I agreed to let him follow me around and kind of, like, analyze my behavior.
Oh, you were a suspect?
Yeah, I was a suspect.
Oh, okay.
So I let him follow me around. And I start watching Tim Thomerson movies. And he's fucking murdering everybody. And then I just look at this guy and I think,
he thinks I'm a murderer,
fuck,
even
I'm
way more
to jail.
Well, you should go to jail for watching Tim Thomerson movies, honestly.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I've always kind of been drawn to amusement park type movies because of the creepiness of them, I guess. And even the pictures on the internet, like I look at the pictures of Six Flags post Katrina, and they just didn't give a shit. After it was all destroyed, nobody cleaned it up. Nobody did anything to it.
You have to
ask
yourself, why in the hell would you? That would be so expensive.
Oh, right, absolutely. I'm not saying that they should. I'm just saying that they haven't.
And it's extremely terrifying.
And it's very, very scary.
Well, I mean, I think just the general idea of an amusement park being abandoned is extremely terrifying and uncanny because you never see them that way.
Right.
Well, you always see them full of people. And as soon as there's no one around, it's like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
That's when Scooby and the gang show up.
Exactly.
Right. Even Kentucky Kingdom, when it's been abandoned here for the last couple years,
yeah, it's real scary.
Yeah, right? It's kind of creepy when you drive past it and everything's all overgrown with shit.
Yep.
But it's obviously opening back up because I want to go somewhere where people lose their feet.
Yeah. We haven't forgotten about that, Kentucky Kingdom. We haven't forgotten about that at all.
It's like, hey, maybe if somebody else buys it and opens it up under a new name and gets rid of a couple of the rides.
Isn't it still called Kentucky Kingdom?
It is still called Kentucky Kingdom. It's not
the
Six
land
Flags
where
Kingdom.
No one has feet.
Well, you know what? We've made amazing advancement in feet replacement technology.
Oh, that's true.
Yeah, we have the Blade Runner, who is a murderer. Allegedly.
Yeah. Allegedly.
I think they did get rid of that ride, but I can't remember.
The Hellevator?
Yeah, I think so. And they got rid of the Vampire, which was the one that literally
every 5 fucking seconds would break down.
Literally.
Every 5 fucking
literally every
seconds.
Time I ever went to Kentucky Kingdom, that roller coaster got stuck upside down.
We rode it. And right before we got on, it got stuck. And then right after we got on, it got stuck. We were the lucky one rider that got to ride it the real way you're supposed to ride it. Not just stopping halfway and being like, well, here we are for 20 minutes.
I remember it was in the paper because the people got stuck upside down for like an hour and a half.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it was a daily issue. Like, close the ride. Yeah. Grow a fucking brain.
Close the fucking park is more like it.
And then reopen it 10 years later, and no one will know.
My biggest complaint with Kentucky Kingdom, and this, like, stops me from going to theme parks altogether. Like, I still go every once in a while, but no matter what, there's always turds in the wave pool. Always a piece of poop in the wave pool. And it just
go to the wave pool, Steven. You know people are going to shit their pants.
It always just seems to gravitate toward me. Like, I'm just sitting there chilling. And
why
no
didn't you bring
what,
this up in the Dan Aykroyd, or not the Dan Aykroyd podcast?
The Ramis podcast.
Yeah.
I mean, seriously, it's like, I'm underwater, I'm good, and then I open my eyes, and there's just shit. But yes, so let's get to the movies that we're doing.
Okay. The Funhouse.
Yeah, we'll start with The Funhouse, which I had never seen before.
Directed by Tobe Hooper. I think the writer was Lawrence Block, so.
Yeah, Lawrence Block wrote Funhouse.
Such wonderful movies as Captain America.
1990 Captain America. We definitely podcasted that movie.
Yeah, and do you know why? Because it's very shitty.
It is extremely shitty.
Well, just because of fake ears. Well, that's the only part I saw. I looked at a picture.
The movie came out in 1981. It stars Elizabeth Berridge, Sean Carson, Jean Austin, Jack McDermott. A lot of people that I don't recognize. Rightfully so, because I don't think I've seen any of them in anything else.
Marco the Magnificent was the Phantom of the Paradise.
Oh, okay. Well, see, I haven't seen that bitch. William Finley is that guy's name. Okay, Kevin Conway. I do recognize Kevin Conway.
First of all, who on the cover? It's Murder Clown. Is not even in the fucking movie.
No. And we've talked about that several times.
God damn it to hell.
Phil fucking hates us, by the way.
I hate it so much, and it's not like it's a surprise. I know they're doing it to get me to watch the movie because I'm like, oh, look at that scary-ass looking clown. This is probably going to be a scary clown in this movie. No clowns. I don't even think there's even the appearance of a clown in the movie.
No, there's just those like shitty papier-mâché like animatronic clowns that they have in the haunted house.
But not like this, though.
No.
This was completely fabricated just for the movie cover to fool me into watching the movie.
Fooled you.
Yeah, Spaceball.
Seriously, though, I think I have this just idea in my brain that Tobe Hooper is a good director. And he's not.
Even though you should know better.
I should know better, because
yeah, he does have some good movies.
He's got two good movies.
You know what he is?
And Life Force.
And Life Force.
Two good movies and Life Force.
Which is pretty good.
It's good if you want to watch 80s titties for an hour and a half.
I don't have a problem with that.
I don't have a problem with it, but
I can watch everything else that has
and it's
titties.
Not just her tits. She's completely naked.
Whoa.
It's true.
A
it's
lot.
True. Pretty much the whole movie,
yeah,
like, as far as I know.
Exactly.
Texas Chainsaw Massacre is one of my favorite horror movies. And actually, they're re-releasing Texas Chainsaw Massacre, not Texas Chainsaw. That movie blows. But Texas Chainsaw Massacre, the original, is being re-released this summer in theaters in, like, high def and Dolby Digital.
I'd rather watch it in its original gritty version. I don't need it cleaned up.
I'd like to see it cleaned up. Well, I've seen it in its original gritty version, and I'd like to see it with the full sound. I want to hear the screaming and chainsaws in my fucking ears at a theater.
I think there's something we need to address right now, because I think this is a huge, huge issue that like half the population seems to think is the case. First of all, the Texas Chainsaw Massacre movie was almost undoubtedly shot on extremely high-grain film, so it's going to have that grittiness regardless.
Yeah.
They can't clean that up because it's part of the movie. They're going to restore it to whatever it was shot, whatever it looked like when they shot it, basically. Which, that's what HD is. You know, they have this idea in their mind of tapes being, you know, at least they had that, like, special quality. And they did. Tapes had a way different look, but...
Much like the sound with vinyl and... CDs that vintage,
right? But
look.
Except for vinyl is a higher quality sound, whereas VHS tapes is extremely compressed and shitty. But if that's how you remember it, then maybe you don't want to see it good.
Right.
But don't be mistaken and think, like many people do, that when they restore the movie, it's going to lose its like classic quality. It makes it a better movie. It makes it the theater version that you saw back then, instead of the turned into a tape or turned into a whatever.
Well, I'm way more stoked for the sound than I am the
right, which
the
is what is what, which is what got compressed, you know, since the beginning of home movies. Like
right.
Tapes had almost the worst sound possible, and then DVDs the sound was better, but it's still getting compressed from hell.
And also, some of us weren't like 20 years old in 1974, like you, DeHart. So
yeah,
I never got the chance.
1974.
I never got the chance to see this in theaters.
I wasn't even born.
We're trying to tell DeHart he's fucking 100.
And Tobe Hooper also did Poltergeist, which is also probably in my top 5 favorite horror movies. And I guess I just have this predetermined idea that no matter what it is, if it's Tobe Hooper, it's going to be good. And then I watch stuff like this, and I watch Eaten Alive.
What makes no sense is that Poltergeist and Texas Chainsaw Massacre are, like, iconic. Those are amazing movies.
And
like,
they're also on different ends of the fucking horror spectrum, too.
Right,
like,
yeah.
Completely different type
there's
of movie.
There's no excuse for whoever created Poltergeist to make the movie Funhouse. Like, there's no excuse for that.
Well, not only that, but, like, if you go into his more recent work, like the movie, what was it, Mortuary, that I've seen, it is just the poorest, the shittiest fucking CGI I've ever seen. Terrible story, terrible acting. I'm like, Tobe Hooper, my, how the mighty have fallen, sir.
Well, dude, I think a lot of these older guys haven't transitioned well. I mean, because, like,
I agree with that fully.
I really love early Argento stuff.
Uh-huh.
It's like the last good movie I think he really did was Opera in like '89.
Right.
And it did a whole bunch of mediocre, like, kind of murder mysteries, Hitchcock ripoffs, that kind of thing. One of them's like, do you like Hitchcock? Is the name of the title.
which may or may not be foreshadowing to the other movie we're going to talk about.
But the absolute worst, his version of Dracula.
Oh, that's on Netflix. I added that to
it
my
Instagram. It is so fucking bad.
Is it shitty? Isn't Christopher Lee in that, or somebody big in that?
Rutger Hauer.
Oh, okay.
He's the big name in the movie. It is just so fucking shitty. There's horrible CGI in it. Everything is lit like they're filming porn.
Well, it's like when Christy Swanson told us to go question the great Wes Craven whenever we shit-talked Deadly Friend. And I'm just like, the great Wes Craven? He's made like 3 good movies ever. Ever! Fuck Wes Craven. Fuck you, Wes Craven. And after this, and after Funhouse...
Stop calling out Wes Craven. If he wants to be a fan of the show, I say let him.
But, okay, let's talk about the plot of Funhouse a little bit. It kind of opens up...
I don't think there's enough about the little boy in this movie. To me,
oh, yeah.
He is the person of interest for this film. And there's not much of him in it. He doesn't really do much most of the time. But in the beginning, he's a little fucking creep.
Yeah, like...
Yeah.
First of all, who, like, breaks into the bathroom and, like, looks at their older sister naked? Like, what?
And no reaction whatsoever. Like, just like... And, like, staring at her titties.
Yeah.
He tried
to make porn of her, but she just happened to put a robe on before she went looking to beat his ass.
Yeah.
Like, he's hiding in the closet waiting for her to come find him because it's like, who the fuck hides in the closet? Like, obviously, he's going to be in there. That's what I'm saying. Like, He is. This is not a clever place to hide. No. He knows she's going to find him, and he's going to take a picture of her tits when he does. But she just happens to have been, you know, had the presence of mind to put a robe on before asshole hunting.
It reminded me a little bit of Bloody Birthday when. Have you seen that, DeHart?
Yeah.
When the little girl is like, sets up a peep show for her sister in their closet.
Well, in that movie, the little sister is kind of farming out the peep show to her little pervert friends.
Right. Right, I mean, she's trying to turn a profit. He's just a straight pervert.
That's
he wants to later beat his little gherkin to fucking pictures of his sister's 80s titties. Which, by the way...
Beat his gherkin?
Well, at this point, you know, he's 8 or whatever.
So it's a gherkin.
Yeah.
Which point does it transform from gherkin to dick?
Well, later.
Okay.
I'm thinking puberty.
Okay. Okay, go on.
Anyways, so... In very psycho fashion, you know, attacks his sister in the bathroom with a rubber knife, and, you know, the viewer doesn't know it's rubber. He's like, maybe he just went fucking crazy and decided to kill his sister. Like,
yeah, totally.
Straight up Michael Myers style.
Well, it totally starts off like Halloween and
right, I mean, it's
Black
like a,
Christmas.
It's like a merge between Halloween, Black
through,
Christmas,
through the
and
eyes,
Psycho.
Through the eyes
of
the villain.
Bathroom
right.
murder
exactly.
shower scene. And, like, the classic pulls back the curtain, stab, you know. You know it's not real because he stabs at her like 5 times and she's still standing there like, what? But it doesn't show that it's... It doesn't matter.
Yeah.
The point is, this kid is a fucking weirdo and wants his sister either naked or dead, as we'll talk about later, has a perfect opportunity to save his sister from certain death. Doesn't do shit about it. Knows she's being tortured. Doesn't do shit.
Well, she threatened him with gypsy curses, man.
No. She did not threaten him with a gypsy curse.
She threatened him with revenge.
With
that
ultimate
he would not
revenge.
Be able to foresee.
Right.
Then unforeseeable
that would revenge. That would scar him for the rest of his fucking life is what she basically said.
Yeah, which is basically a gypsy curse.
Whatever. I guess maybe we're splitting hairs here. But the simple fact of the matter is, he's a twisted little fuck, and they don't even really address that.
No, never.
He's just like, well... There he goes, off to go become Michael Myers and murder his family. Really,
and dressed
really.
Like Billy Crystal.
Exactly.
He's dressed like Billy Crystal through this whole fucking movie. It is uncanny.
Yeah, it's like a tiny Billy. And you know what? It very literally could have been, like, the idea.
And I was buying into this movie at first because it kind of had the Texas Chainsaw feel at first because you had, like, the 4 teenagers going into the amusement park and you were kind of like, okay... maybe this is gonna just basically turn out into a pretty awesome slasher flick, kind of like TCM. And then I saw Frankenstein get jerked off, and I was just like,
"Well, you've skipped over so much."
I know, but I can't. I couldn't hold it in anymore.
Like, first of all, well, it didn't because you didn't know he was a crazy monster at that time. He was just some nameless guy that can't talk that has a Frankenstein mask on.
Right.
It's like. Why is Frankenstein getting jerked off? You don't find it to be particularly strange or creepy or, like, abnormal?
I kind of did.
Well...
Because it really didn't look like a mask.
I feel like that's the kind of, like, strange sexual situations that you find in Texas Chainsaw Massacre. And that's what I think he was, like, hearkening back to.
Okay.
But it didn't come through. I didn't see that and think... Jesus, God, what the fuck? I just saw a guy paying a skanky gypsy to give him a handy for $100.
Oh, it came through all right.
Okay.
You're
kind of underestimating the fact that he can't speak. He's grunting. He doesn't know money. So you know that there's something severely wrong with the fellow that's underneath the mask.
I get that, but to me that's not... That doesn't even begin to approach the fucked upness of having, like, of just gross incest, for instance. Like
okay.
From Texas
yeah.
Chainsaw Massacre.
Or at the beginning of this movie.
Right. Yeah, I guess that's true. See, I found that, like I was saying before, infinitely more creepy. That little kid is so much more creepy than the actual villain in this movie.
They're
so much more creepy.
Okay. Before she even leaves for this date, she's sitting on the couch with her parents, and her dad's saying, hey, you should stay away from that murder fair. They came through here last year, and that's when those dead bodies showed up. So,
no, I mean, it was supposedly
it
was the same fair from another town. Like, that's the fair that caused all them problems in Springdale, or wherever the fuck it was.
I don't give a fuck. Murder fair? Not going.
First of all, you can almost assume that all fairs are murder fairs. At least I do. I certainly do. So, if you're being informed this specific fair has an actual reputation for being murdery, don't go! I don't care what fucking Chaz says or whatever the hell his name is. He had a very douchey name. What was his name?
I don't know. I didn't write down.
But he looked very douchey.
Well, I'm fucking looking, because it was very douche.
Buzz. It was Buzz.
Buzz! Exactly. Exactly. And that's right. Fucking the older brother from Home Alone.
Why would you take a date to a fucking carnival?
Well, especially a murder carnival.
First of all, DeHart, obviously you would take a date to a carnival to show how ridiculously awesome you are at winning at rigged games.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
If you want to show what a good catch you are in comparison to the carnies that are there, maybe. I don't know. That could be a possible thing.
Hey, look how good-looking I am next to this mutant.
Like, do either one of you guys know when this movie was supposed to be taking place?
I'm assuming 1981.
Yeah, I was going to say in the 80s.
Was that when it was made?
Yeah, 81.
You said it was in 81.
At the beginning of the podcast, you said this was made in 91. I was very confused.
Oh, I meant 81.
I was going to say, this movie is a completely different context. If it was really made in 91 and I saw it in 91, I would have been like, oh, this is a movie trying to be a 70s movie.
All
right. Because like, no, that's what it looks like.
Very likely it started production in 71.
So that makes perfect sense. Yeah. It fits right in there. So, okay, it's not as good as I thought it was. It's even worse, which I didn't think it was good to begin with.
And that clown on the cover.
There's no excuse. First of all, the monster is perfectly gross enough to put on the cover of the film. And it is, in some situations.
The sound it makes is so... Okay, well, let's get there first.
Let's stop skipping ahead.
Okay, so she goes to the fair against her dad's warning.
And her better judgment.
Yes, everyone's better judgment. Any human being's better judgment.
Well, but they all deserve to die because they were smoking the weed in the car.
Well, the thing is that they're fucking morons.
Yeah, those three things put together is pretty much just like recipe for murder.
Most of the movie is just going around the carnival. Mm-hmm. And it's like, hey, this is a great place to take a date, huh? Hey, why don't you check out the freak show and
took
strippers?
It forever to get into it. That was one of my main issues. It was like, I get it. They're at the fucking carnival.
Yeah.
I was torn about that first 45 minutes of the movie because it really did take at least 45 minutes for them to get into the part where they're like, something's not right. Something strange is afoot at the murder carnival. Like,
strange things are
afoot. Yeah, exactly. It took them a long time to get there, but at the same time, I feel I was at least slightly more attached to these characters than I am in the slasher films where they're just like, hey, look, it's Jane, and here's Buzz. And guess what? Now they're being murdered 2 minutes after the movie started. I appreciate that they tried to, like, establish you giving any kind of a shit for the characters, but you guys are both right. That could have been cut by 15 minutes at least.
And I get that. I get your point, but here's my response to it. If you're going to set up the characters and the storyline for that fucking long, the payoff better be goddamn awesome.
Right.
Like, these people better get the shit murdered out of them in the best ways, and it better be really entertaining to watch.
It was entertaining because of how terrible it was.
Well, but it wasn't. Like, the deaths were fucking terrible.
Lame.
They were fucking shitty.
I can only think of one death even in the movie that they actually showed, now that I'm trying to think of it.
Well, the hanging guy...
He got hung, but a rope came down, pulled him up, that was it.
Yeah.
He died.
And then he got axed in the head.
Right, but they didn't show that either.
Right.
Well, he was already dead at that point.
Right.
Well, I know that.
It was post-mortem head axe.
Yeah.
Another metal band name, by the way.
So many great metal band
names. Post-mortem head axe.
I think the problem with the first 45 minutes is that it doesn't tie in well enough. I mean, right. I think that's the strongest part of the film, actually.
Yeah. I was thinking that same thing. Like,
well, because it could have set up for something really good.
The freak show ties in because you have the cow that has a split head and a fetus in a jar that has the exact same mutation as the cow.
Right. And the fish mermaid. No, I'm just kidding.
I think they reference that. They say that the fetus was related to the monster
that
in the movie,
ties
who
in.
Also has a split monster face.
Right.
Yeah, that ties in. I wish more things tied in.
Right, right.
Instead, it's kind of an isolated case of murder. It's like there's only one murderer in the murder carnival. So I guess it's a little more realistic.
I don't think anybody in the carnival gives a fuck if other murders happen, because they act like, oh man, we really stepped in it now. We done killed the gypsy. And then it's like, we could probably just say it was other people that killed
him. That's only the monster's dad, the Barker.
Right.
Which, actually, there are three Barkers, but they didn't change them up enough to where you'd really tell without looking at the credits.
Right.
Who was who?
Yeah, well, I mean, no, there's three barkers. They're all played by the same guy. So
right, but you didn't know which one was which.
Well, I don't know. I don't know which one was which.
That's what I'm saying.
I can't tell them apart. I just know that they're different from looking into credits.
Right.
But, yeah, he's the only one to say, you know, that's kind of blasé about murder.
Right. But, well, I guess that's true. And also, I just feel like his reaction to, we just found one of the people that I work with on a daily basis murdered by my mutant Frankenstein split-headed monster face son.
Well, they're fucking carnival pieces of shit. Obviously, he doesn't give a shit. And there's no reason to expect that he would.
His reaction to having lost that money that got stolen, compared to, he's like making him beat himself and shit.
Dude, like, this is my expectation if a carnival worker finds a body. Let's just throw it in the fryer.
Yeah.
that's
we don't have to buy a cow for tomorrow.
Yeah, exactly. Like, no. Fucking awful.
Okay, since we're basically there, our four teams. The nerd who is probably the biggest moron in the fucking movie. His girlfriend.
Buzz.
You have our hero. Yeah. Well, our hero lady.
And then Buzz.
And Buzz. Her douchebag first date. And they decided to stay in the funhouse overnight.
Right. That was the disconnect. We didn't even ride the funhouse first and then go, hey, you know, it'd be radical if we stayed in the funhouse and smoked a bunch of weed and sucked on each other's titties.
They did it because Billy Daniels did it the week before.
Right. Or the month or whatever, last year. No, exactly. That's what I mean. Like, that's the disconnect. Like, you have all this badass, like, shit that they could be terrorized by, like, angry, murderous strippers that they see, or, like, the guy that's telling him he's a pussy when he hits, you know, the barbell thing.
Or the lady that, in the bathroom that was telling him that
God's watching you, but I'm just gonna be walking around for the rest of the movie yelling that. Pointlessly.
Apparently God's watching you poop.
Yeah. And that's concentrated evil coming out of your butthole.
And that's poop. Why he's watching.
Yeah. But yeah, like, there's no tie-in. Like, they don't even ride the ride first and then decide to stay. Like, they experience a bunch of carnival shenanigans, various carnival shenanigans ensue, and then they decide, just right off the bat, hey, let's ride this ride and then stay in there, okay?
The funhouse is really poor, too. We didn't mention that at all. Even for a 1981 funhouse.
I have a rebuttal for that.
It's huge. There's no reason something that's inside of a trailer should be that big.
Yeah. Yeah, spatially, it made no sense.
Yeah,
obviously,
none.
It's like
whatsoever.
That is like a warehouse you're riding around in.
Yeah. It has layers.
Yeah,
I mean, there's floors to it.
Yeah, that made no fucking sense.
Yeah, you can't move that in and out of a town. That's retarded. A quadruple decker funhouse bus. It's not portable.
So they've stayed in the funhouse, and her brother followed her for some reason. I guess just wanted to be creepy again.
Well, I mean, she told him she was going to take him. Like, okay, before the movie starts, she says, I'm going to take you to the funhouse. We don't see this happen. And then she says, fuck you, I'm not taking you to the funhouse. You looked at my tits, and that's nasty.
You look at my tits, you're not going to the funhouse.
I'm not taking you to the fucking movies or nothing. You're a piece of shit. And then he's like, well, fuck you then. I'm just going to sneak out and go to the fucking carnival anyways. With my my sock full of pennies.
It's not like he went to ride anything on his own. He just went and watched them.
Yeah. Once again,
very voyeuristic.
I very much maintain that this is the scariest character in the show. Like, we're talking about a movie with monsters that dress up like Frankenstein and, you know, people that have no problem with murdering other people for no reason. Shit like this. And then this little boy is definitely by far the scariest thing, and they don't address it at all.
So
he saw them go into the funhouse and not come back out. So he's just standing out there watching still.
And they are looking through the floors because they hear the gypsy woman talking, basically. And she is basically just getting money out of this guy on Frankenstein.
She's fooling this, like, mutant retard guy.
Right.
Into giving her money just to, like, touch his dick for 3 seconds.
Yeah.
Which is all it took, apparently.
She's turning Franken tricks.
Then she got monster jizz on her and started wiping her monster jizz all over the place.
Yeah, well.
And he wanted his money back, too, because
he was like, hey, that was bullshit. Like,
well,
I could do that.
He paid for fucking. He didn't get fucking. He only got a handy.
Yeah.
I feel like any hooker in anywhere in the world would have been like, okay, fine, I'll give you back 75 of it, because I didn't do anything.
I literally just poked it.
Yeah. But that was her plan all along. She never had any intention of actually having sex. Well, she literally says it. She goes, like, I would fuck your crazy monster ass. Like, she literally, when they're arguing, she says this, throws it in his face like, you're a fucking creep, and I'm never going to fuck you.
Well, then he chokes her out.
Yeah, she gets taught a lesson by getting the shit beat out of her.
And throws her into the fuse box.
Yeah. Oh, which was so poor. So fucking awful.
Can you explain to me this fucking fuse box controls everything in the entire trailer, which is like 100 miles wide. And if you even step near it, it just goes on the fritz and just fries everything in the world. So poor. I don't know. Spend $5 and put a fucking metal cover over it.
Oh, yeah. It was fucking poor as shit. So then, now is when you get to see the monster, because he pulls off the
Franken's
mask, and the sound that he makes is just hilarious. It's just like... He is so fucking mad. I told Philip it looked like the haunted mask from Goosebumps. What did I say?
He said it fucked something. I can't remember. You had to look that up.
I am going to look that up real quick.
The dude from Goonies?
No, it wasn't Sloth.
That's a good one, though.
Haunted Max, but... Sloth from Goonies. There you go.
And it's the poorest looking. Like, it looks very 80s, like, Fright Night style. I mean, it's very clearly 80s practical polyfoam mold.
Honestly, I like the Frankenstein mask better.
I did too.
It was all fucking greasy.
Yeah, that's what I was saying earlier.
Is a mask get greasy?
Well, that's what I said to Philip. It didn't really look that much like a mask. It looked. I thought that was his face at first because I'd never seen this before, but obviously not.
I think we're missing the biggest point of the movie is that the biggest point of our complaints about the movie is that we have this whole buildup. And every death is lamer than the last death.
Oh, yeah.
Like, Gypsy Woman just gets strangled to death. Nothing special there. Nothing horrifying about being strangled to death, really. I mean, if you've seen any movies or television or anything. Not for the watcher, it's not horrifying.
So, while he's out of the room getting his dad, who is the carnival barker, they go down there and they're checking... Well, our fucking idiot nerd goes in to check on the...
To make sure she's dead.
Make sure she's dead. And while he's in there, he steals all the fucking money. Stealing money from someone he knows just murdered someone. Do you steal money from murderers?
I probably wouldn't. I'm not a fucking idiot. But
nerdiot.
That's one thing that I don't get. Usually the nerdiest person is like the voice of reason and gets killed. But because of other people's incompetence.
No, our nerd is pulling double fucking duty because... He's not only the nerd, he's also the bigger douchebag compared to just the douchebag.
Yeah.
And this guy is a straight-up textbook jock-asshole douchebag. His name is fucking Buzz. Yeah, I mean, unless you're Buzz Lightyear, you can't have the name Buzz. I feel like his last anything name but a douche.
Buchanan.
Yeah, Buzz Buchanan is probably
is that a Tim Thomerson name? Buzz Buchanan?
I don't know. I don't think so.
I think it is.
Billy Bones is.
So...
Brick Bardo.
Right. Billy Bones. No, it isn't. So, our nerdy retard friend who just keeps fucking up drops his lighter through the floorboards and basically says, guess what? Not only did somebody lose the money, it wasn't your retard son that you think lost the money. It was us, the intruders.
It's like, not only did he steal the money, he gave away the fact that they were there.
Yeah, he... God, everyone killed. He was the worst, and I'm glad he got fucking strangled to death.
Yeah.
And an axe in the head post-mortem.
Like you said, lame murder after lame murder.
Alright, let's line them up. Gypsy, strangled to death. Nerd. He gets a fucking Scooby-Doo noose comes out of nowhere and just magically goes around his head. You know how fucking hard it would be to just drop a noose onto someone's head and it go on there first try?
A Scooby-Doo?
I guess they... It was a Scooby-Deuce. Ew, a Scooby-Deuce. Can you imagine how, like, disgusting Scooby-Deuce poop would be? After, like, just 4,000 Scooby snacks a day? Just 200 pounds of shit.
What about those tall fucking sandwiches,
yeah,
man?
And everything else that him and Shaggy eat. But anyway, go on, I'm sorry.
So anyway, I guess because they're carnies, they can do the extremely unlikely, like, rigged ride, throw a ball into a basket that has a spring-loaded bottom, shit like that. But really, I thought it was maybe the silliest thing ever that he was actually able to, like, lasso this guy's head with this noose that he just happened to have, or he's an expert knot tier.
Yeah, the amount of time between the time they get found out and the time he's hanging, it's like nothing.
Yeah, it's like I've got an idea. I'm going to find these guys, and I'm going to go get my noose first and hang him. It's like...
Maybe he had a pre-tied noose.
If he already had the noose, fine. But how in the fuck did he get this onto his head? Like...
He went from a floor below them to a floor above them in a trailer that shouldn't have multiple floors, and he manages to do this in a matter of seconds.
Yeah.
It's Carney magic, man.
Well, be Carney magic, be that as it may. He does all this and immediately takes the body he just hung, pulls it back up, goes around, puts it in the cart, sends it back through. In like a second. He's so fast. And he doesn't slow down for the rest of the movie. He continues to hang people in clever, creative ways. It's the Michael Myers syndrome, where he positions bodies in scary ways. It's like, why would he ever do that?
Not to mention that we forgot to say that this guy is like half the size of a normal man, by the way.
He's very short.
Yeah, like he's not...
He does have retard strength, which he demonstrates later. But he's a little man.
You're mixing characters, buddy. The one Frankenstein is he's fairly decent sized.
No, and he's smaller.
Is he?
Yeah, he was like half the size of the gypsy woman.
It's like, I don't think he
wasn't that small, but he was smaller.
Yeah, like he definitely wasn't a full grown man.
I don't think we ever saw him next to somebody for very long.
You saw him next to the woman when he was wringing her neck and he was reaching up toward her neck.
I thought he was lifting her.
No.
Well, maybe he was. Okay, the fact of the matter is he was short because anytime he encountered anybody, he was just at eye level at most. And these are carnies we're talking about, so everyone's shorter than normal.
Well, I knew that the Barker was short.
Right.
Because he gets a...
Bob.
He's right up against a...
We knew Bob was short.
Whenever he gets a... Bob Barker.
I was wondering if okay.
He gets impaled with a sword.
Right.
When they're trying to escape, I guess at the exit of the ride.
Right.
Yeah.
Which I don't know why they didn't check it earlier.
There's no possible way the exit can be open.
It isn't, though. Right. It's locked.
Can you fucking bet? Okay. It's a goddamn trailer. My ass could knock the side of a fucking trailer wall out. I swear to God I could if I wanted to get out fast enough.
There's all kinds of shit laying all over the fucking place.
Or maybe grab that axe that you put in the dude's head that went by.
That axe would do really great on a fan.
Yeah.
Remember that fan? That's huge.
Or possibly even better on the guy trying to kill you.
Meanwhile, while they're in here being murdered.
Meanwhile...
Her brother is out there, and he got scared by something, and he's traumatized, and one of them has taken into his trailer, and he talks real creepy whenever his parents come to pick him up.
I didn't understand that scene at first. I was like, what is happening right now? Because I couldn't remember what the parents even looked like. I'm like, who are these two people about to, like, buy this child off of this carny? No, like, no. I don't know what is happening. Like, he's talking...
Yeah, those were the parents.
I mean, the parents were just entirely too casual about the fact that a carny called them in the middle of the night and said, hey, you know, I got your baby. Come get him. Like, oh, you mean that kid I thought was asleep upstairs? Holy shit. No, they're just like, yeah, he'll never sneak away again. It's like... You guys are fucking terrible. You should be crying. Like, your child was fucking missing.
Bring out 20,000 in tokens if you ever want to see him alive.
Yeah, exactly.
Or maybe two pieces of funnel cake.
Two pieces of funnel cake. I feel like if you're a carny, you can probably get funnel cake pretty cheap.
Yeah,
yeah, especially if it's made from people.
Yeah, no shit.
But while they're out there, it's like, you can see them. They've got the kid. She is at the window, it's not a window, it's a fan. There's like a vent.
The exhaust fan or the
intake
fan.
And she cannot yell loud enough because of this fucking fan that her parents can hear. And she
just
sees them drive
away. Which is bullshit. Which I'm not going to get into. That is bullshit. But the kid knew she was fucking there.
Oh, yeah, he saw her.
He definitely looked
at her.
He purposefully didn't tell them, his parents, that she was in there. Like, no, she's in there.
Well, I think they added in that flashback in his
head. He's like,
where it's like,
I'm gonna fucking whoop your ass! Or whatever she says.
I will pay you back and you will not be able to foresee how I do it.
Right.
I think that he thinks that he's being fucked with.
Maybe.
And it's like, oh, this is a joke.
Maybe, I can see that.
And that was my idea.
Well, I mean, I guess that's possible, but my takeaway was, oh yeah, she threatened to do something to me. She can just fucking get murdered by a monster face.
Well, we're running a little long on this movie, so let's go to the next one. Do you have anything else really to say about Funhouse?
Extremely lackluster last 30 minutes, and that ruined the movie, which could have been extremely good.
Yeah.
And they could have done anything with the little creepy child kid that was just a straight-up psychopath, I'm pretty sure, in the making. Like, he clearly had no emotions, just loves murder, and, like, had... It was really...
Just
yeah.
Any storyline development whatsoever,
like,
with him.
If your sister catches you, like... after you've done something terrible to her, and she's screaming in your face, and you just look back at her like, you're not going to do shit, because I'm going to murder you when you're asleep. Like, you are a fucking murderer, psychopath, little, you know, a sociopath.
It's like, I'd seen this before, but previously I'd thought, oh, yeah, that's how the movie ends. There's a whole other scene after that where she finally does, well, I guess, kill the bad guy.
Right.
And it's like, I completely had forgotten about that. And I thought the movie ended on parents just driving away and her. It's like, no! Which would have been okay.
That would have been a better ending.
That would have been okay.
And it's like, I completely forgot about the other part.
The part where she fight. Oh my god, one thing I have to say. That end scene, it is literally 7 or 8 minutes of just her screaming as loud as she can. She has no fighting skills. She can't do anything except for just scream a lot and then walk towards him when he's clearly on a hook and get caught by him again. Like, oh, there he goes. I've electrocuted him and he's hurt and he's hung on a hook and he's going towards the doom gears or whatever.
Yeah,
and they're going to pinch his legs off. But I'm still going to get close enough to him and keep screaming.
He's literally being crushed in those gears for minutes on end.
Yeah.
It's unbelievable.
This guy who has already been stabbed and has been in many altercations since having, you know, since the movie started.
Since finding him, yeah.
Yeah. He's still strong enough to withstand getting crushed for, like, a year and still has, like, he's still holding on to
the ability to grab.
Like, he's gonna, it looks like for a second, he's gonna pull her into the gears with him.
Yeah.
Which, I mean, if you weren't gonna end it on the other thing, maybe go ahead and pull her through the gears. You know,
yeah.
That way everyone dies.
As, yeah. Like, the monster comes back and grabs her right at
which,
the end.
Once again, would have been a better ending. Instead of her just walking off crying like a post-prom night reject, like...
It would have been nice if maybe they put in, like, a sad Incredible Hulk music.
Or, like, even if she, like, went and told somebody, and then they came back, and the carnival was gone.
Okay, right. Yeah, that would work, too.
Right, you know, because they get up and move.
If she's doing that, she has to fucking run away from the fucking carnival in the morning.
Right.
Run, don't walk, run away, and then bring people back, and they're gone.
Right. Way better ending. We should have wrote this, Toby.
Yeah, there's 100 endings, 100 things that could be fixed. And the reason we care so much, the reason we're bitching for 53 minutes about this movie, is because... it had serious potential.
It took us almost 20 minutes to get started, so...
Yeah, that's true. That's true.
Yeah,
well,
sorry.
Anyway.
Sorry, guys.
More
I had to tell you about my murder
your
rides.
Murderous rides. Well, at any rate...
Let's move on.
I give it a D. No, not even that. I mean, watch the first 5 minutes, because you'll see the creepiest monster in the movie, the little kid, and you'll also see some soapy titties. So, win-win. Stop watching it after that.
Or at least until you get to see Billy Crystal running around.
That's pretty
you
funny.
You get a good laugh out of it once you realize,
it's like,
oh,
that's
Billy
that's
Crystal.
That's tiny Billy Crystal.
That's even tinier Billy Crystal.
Right, exactly.
Okay.
All right, so let's move on to another very underwhelming movie, in my opinion.
Which, I think this is the second week in a row where we've picked out two movies and then them be polar opposites of each other.
Yeah.
I mean, this one less than this last week's, but... because you are still at an amusement-type place, and
right.
Things are creepy. But other than that, they have no similarities, which is fine. And this movie is way more, like, art house style. Like,
well, the reviews that are out there, and people blew this up. Like, they were like, oh my god, it's psychological thriller, and blah, 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 and made it out to be just
Do you know why that is? It's because no one has seen classic films.
It's true.
They don't know shit about real psychological thrillers. They don't know shit about Hitchcock.
Right.
They don't know shit about any movies that were made in this exact same way. They don't give a fuck. The only thing that makes this movie truly, like, unique is just the simple fact of knowing that it was shot at Disney World and Disneyland without the knowledge of Disney.
No, it was ballsy.
Yeah, extremely ballsy. And I find that the technical, like, hurdles that they had to jump over to get this movie to really happen were more interesting than the movie, to be frank. Like, the fact that they had to, like, hide all the mics and, like, hide all the, you know, scripts and cameras and everything, like, shoot it all on Canon 5D Mark IIs, because those are normal-ish looking cameras that you wouldn't necessarily assume are shooting a film, you know?
And the movie we're talking about, of course, is Escape from Tomorrow, 2013, directed by Randy Moore. And this kind of blew up in my mind to do as a podcast because it's more of an independent film. You know, of course, we do a lot of...
We like to do movies that you probably haven't seen or probably wouldn't want to watch.
Right.
I mean, that's the, you know...
Most of the time. I mean, we do
blockbusters, too, but, you know.
But this was one I picked out because I had seen the cover of it. I had seen the reviews of it. I liked the fact that it was shot in black and white from the screenshots that I had seen. And,
which, again, was a choice made specifically because of their limitations of what they could do.
Right.
They had no control over the lighting, so they had to shoot this thing entirely monochromatically, which helps, you know, technically, I'm not going to get into it, but it helps technically with
you're not
controlling
be able to
the amount of lighting in different scenes.
As much... You won't be able to spot out the green screen as easily.
Right.
Well, that's true, except for it was still incredibly obvious.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, but it's
painfully.
It was a little less, I mean, because you wouldn't be able to match real outdoor light with fake indoor, you're on a green screen.
You will never do it. No one can.
And
it's called you don't have access to the sun. Like, I mean, really, not for your own personal use.
I'm a huge Disney fan, and so the thought of, like...
And also, you've recently visited this
exact
park.
I went to Disney less than a year ago, and so the idea of it was really intriguing to me, and that's why I picked this movie. Unfortunately, like you said, you could never even put this in the same fucking, like... book as a Hitchcock film.
You could talk about it alongside Hitchcock if you wanted to, but just know that there's nothing groundbreaking about the actual film itself.
No, not at all.
Simply the fact that, I mean, how it was made, it was groundbreaking, I think. But that aside...
That's it.
Like,
I mean,
the movie is basically a crappy Hitchcock ripoff.
Well, I think the main problem is they foreshadow what the payoff is way too early in the fucking movie.
Oh, yeah.
It's like instantly you know, oh, yeah, I get it.
Yeah.
Beating us over the head with it.
So let's talk a little bit about the plot. Basically, it opens up and this family is actually already at Disney World. I mean, they're in the hotel.
They've been there. This is the last day.
Right. And the main character finds out that he is fired. Which is the stupidest fucking phone call in the world, by the way. It's just some British guy who's just like, oh, well, I'm afraid I'm going to have to let you go. Pretty much it. He's just like...
When you say it like that, it's like, okay, well, I'll talk to you later. I'll see you on Monday, Jefferson.
Yeah.
But he doesn't want to tell his kids or his
not
wife.
Not the best acting, really.
No,
just overall in the movie. But once again, I find that it's kind of probably difficult to pretend that you're making a movie whenever you're... secretly trying to not pretend that you're making a movie.
Right,
like,
right.
I think they really accomplished something there, sneaking in and making this, but
once again, it
doesn't
hold
up
to
other films of a similar genre.
And most of the film was filmed at Disney World and the hotels on Disney World premises. And you're right, it's got to be tough to get away with that shit without somebody obviously knowing.
Yeah, I mean, you're acting for two different people. Two different, like, personalities. Like, you're not just pretending to be at the park.
But you're
also pretending to be someone else pretending to be at the park.
Right, exactly.
Like, it's a mindfuck, kind of, to even think about it.
I mean, if you just stayed in that character, you would only have to,
But you can't just magically stay in a character. Like, if you're making this film, you gotta be kind of afraid at all times. Like, can you just imagine, like, you're at Disney World filming a film illegally, like, without them knowing, and if you give it away, the director's probably going to be pretty fucking mad at you that you fucked up and, like, ruined his film. Right. Like, at any moment, some Disney employee could just be like, I've seen that guy 50 fucking times today, riding the same ride, and he did the same thing when he came back out.
Yeah. It literally said that he did that.
In the Wikipedia page.
Yeah, well, on the trivia page.
Well, I mean, but also like, that's...
No one gives a shit.
I know that, but I mean, just imagine from their perspective, being actors, trying to pretend, like, trying in your mind not to be obvious that you're pretending to do something. You know what I'm saying? Like,
but not only that, but I'm sure they get a lot of people that sit there and ride the same fucking ride over and over and over again. So, you know, it probably doesn't look out of the normal to them.
I'm not saying that there was any real chance or any very great likelihood that they would get caught, but just the paranoia of being that one fucking actor that fucked it up for everybody, to me, would be a mind fuck. I would be like, it's hard enough to be an actor and pretend like you're someone else. It would be even harder to, you know... To have that in the back of your mind, like, any moment you could be caught.
Well, see, that's not what really came out as ballsy to me. And, I mean, I totally understand where you see that. But what came out as ballsy to me was that the director and the actors and everybody were willing to take the risk of getting their fucking asses sued off by Disney. I mean, Disney, if they wanted to, could own these motherfuckers. Every single person in this movie.
I've thought about it a lot, and I feel like that is definitely a distinct possibility simply because Disney could out-money them on every possible front. All day long, every day, they could buy and sell these motherfuckers.
Right.
Which is, I'm accepting that. But at the same time, I feel like they knew that there's no way in hell Disney would be able to do anything about it because any way you slice it, Disney can't, like, literally buy them.
Right.
So what can they do? Sue them until they have no money? Oh no, I have no money, but I still made this fucking awesome film that I'm now famous for, and now Disney's blown up to epic proportions because of this huge trial.
Now, basically, how it turns out is, if you don't have any money and someone's suing you for something that you don't want to give publicity, every dollar you're spending on legal fees is money that's basically going towards
directly
their
marketing.
Publicity. It's marketing.
Yeah, it's free marketing funded by people that hate
be on
you.
The fucking news.
See,
yeah.
This is where
exactly. This is what I'm saying.
This,
like,
is where
they knew they had them fucked either way. Because it's like, well, if we don't make any money off this film because Disney fucked it into the ground, at least we'll be fucking famous as shit
for getting fucked into the ground by Disney.
No,
I mean, that's what you're saying. We'll be famous for being the people that Disney wanted to fuck into the ground.
It's like The Catcher in the Rye. When it's, you know, banned from the school library, kids will go fucking find it and read it anyway.
Right.
On purpose. They, you know, it's the controversial thing. People would want to see Escape from Tomorrow way more if it was the center of this controversy.
Right.
So it doesn't matter how you break it down. They were going to get away with it in some fashion or what or another.
Unless you're Disney and you just pay people to kill everyone in the film.
Which is super likely. Just wait 5 years and then everyone in this movie is just going to be like the actors that were in Poltergeist. Just like, oh, they mysteriously died in a hotel room.
Yeah.
It's like, what?
They came down with a really bad case of being shot in the fucking head.
It's like, yeah, this, you know, you remember the main actor from Escape from Tomorrow? Yeah. Well, he was found the other day in a closet, hung with his dick out. Like, David Carradine style.
So you're saying that Disney murdered David Carradine?
I'm saying they would definitely take a leaf out of those ninjas' book.
Okay.
There's not a whole lot of, like, I don't want to say solid plot to this, because I feel like a lot of the movie is up for personal interpretation,
yeah.
I guess, of the director and, I guess, of the viewers as well. But there was a few things that I liked about it. Like, I really dug when they were going through...
First of all, for 1 second, let's just talk about what the movie is about, which can be explained very quickly. A man goes to Disney World with his family, becomes crazy because of whatever...
Cat flu.
Because of whatever reason. You can say it's... You can say
a spoiler warning, fucker.
I'm sorry. The cat flu. Spoiler alert.
Because of either the cat flu, or his wife is driving him crazy, or he has a pre-existing mental instability, or brain tumor,
or
something.
Shitty son.
Or yeah, he basically just has something. There's some kind of problem, and they never explain what exactly it is. It's either all in his head, or it's Disney experimenting on him, or whatever. Because they do bring that up later. But for some reason, he goes crazy, starts seeing monsters all over the place, and becomes obsessed with hot French teens.
Yeah, that
oh,
I didn't
really?
Get. I didn't get that part at all.
It's just a fucking perv. That's all there is to it.
That's what we were saying.
As far as the French girls, there's nothing that I could see to really get about them other than the fact that they just represent why he's a piece of shit. He's like chasing these like girls around. At first, there just happens to bump into him like 100 fucking times.
Right.
And then he's like...
And they're like 14.
It's seriously. One of them has fucking braces.
Well,
which I had I know braces one of like them, 2 years ago.
I know one of them's probably at least mid-20s to 30. I think the one without braces is mid-20s to 30. Because
no way.
I checked out her IMDb page.
Well, yeah, maybe
her first
she
part was like 10 years ago, and it was playing groupie. Unless she was an 8-year-old groupie, then she was
maybe,
of age.
Okay, maybe the actress
maybe
is that old.
In real life, she's that old.
In the movie.
She's, like, giggling, and they're giving each other piggyback rides. They're tweens, like,
yeah,
for real.
Yeah, they're totally jailbait.
No older than 17. Like, yeah, jailbait from hell. Which, he makes a wise decision to not, like, go fuck this girl when she's, like, clearly trying to get him to go fuck her, and she spits in his face, and he gets cat flu because of it.
No, but
well,
he
already had it.
Yeah, he definitely had it.
He's been hallucinating the entire time.
Right. Did he already have it, though? Because as soon as she spits in his face... He starts tripping way more harder, and then he has a flashback whenever he thinks about the cat flu. He has a flashback to her spinning right in his face and the infection obviously happening at that moment. Like, they tie it together really strongly there at the end. They're like, cat flu, the sign that you saw that said cat flu on it, nurse crying about cat flu, you have cat flu, spit in the face. Like, they line it up.
She spits in his face at the end of the fucking movie.
Yeah.
He's been hallucinating the whole goddamn time.
I get that, but he doesn't... He's
seeing, like, ridiculous monsters the entire time.
I directly correlated her spitting in his face to her giving him the cat flu.
That may be true, because he was already fucked up in the head, because...
He never coughed once until that happened, and then he started coughing up his goddamn lungs, like, pretty much immediately.
Was he the boy...
He was coughing whenever they first left the hotel room. It's like everybody was coughing.
Well, I mean, that was sort of like the...
Yeah, it's like the very first scene when they're outside. It's like, oh, everybody who's
standing around
is... Didn't
they say something about a carrier? Didn't the nurse say something about a carrier?
Yeah, she says you could be a host and not even know it.
Right. So, maybe...
Which, he could have already had the cat flu, but then why did he flash back to her spitting in his face right when he realized he had the cat flu? It doesn't make sense.
And maybe he's just thinking about, oh... I didn't get to fuck teens.
It's like, I should have fucked teens while I still could. Now I have the cat flu, and I'm going to wake up tomorrow with cat eyes and a crazy Cheshire cat smile.
I'm dying.
My question is, it kept bringing up the part where somebody got decapitated on Big Thunder.
Right, which is almost
Thunder.
Like...
Thunder!
No, Space Mountain. But what I'm saying is... God damn it. But, like, was he on that ride? Was that, like, a flashback to when he was younger and... And, like, is that what he saw, and
they
that's
never,
what kind of fucked him up a little bit?
The thing, I think that's what, to me, that's what makes this movie so drastically different than The Funhouse, in that, when I was talking, brought it up at the beginning, was because it's such an art house type of movie, where it's like, nothing in this movie isn't symbolism, nothing in this movie doesn't relate directly back to some kind of idea that the director had, and much of it, they don't explain at all.
No.
So... It's very open to interpretation, and the director very much wants you to go and read his biography and figure out what the movie really was about so that you can appreciate his art, which I get.
Or maybe wants you to interpret
it
for yourself.
It's a little... Exactly. Or I mean, that's the whole point. Like, it's up for interpretation.
Right.
For anybody to say, okay, he was being experimented on, and it was an ongoing thing. The only reason he was even there was because it was all set up by Disney to begin with.
Right.
And everyone's got the cat flu, whatever the fuck that is. Or maybe it was the hot teen that killed him. Or maybe it was his satanic son.
Or maybe it was his bitch wife.
Yeah, who's a fucking bitch. That was truly my takeaway, was like, the moral of the story is, if your wife's a bitch, kill her. Or, like, don't marry her to begin with.
Like, I thought he was going to kill her. Like, I thought that
I
was
kind of... I was hoping that he would, because I'd have been like, yeah, bitch, what now?
Like, when he got her that Dumbo glass bell or whatever, and she's like, this isn't the one I wanted. I don't like Dumbo.
Well,
and
I mean,
like,
that
bitch,
was...
I just spent, like, literally $200 on this fucking thing, because that's how much they are.
Yeah.
And I got you it. And it's a nice little glass Dumbo bell. Eat shit and die, you fucking bitch.
You ungrateful hoe. part of me is like, yeah, he's not even trying to cover up the fact that he's clearly, like, drooling all over these tweens, which is nasty, and I would have been like, if I'm his wife, I'm like, you need to take a moment and learn to be an adult and not have your tongue roll out like a fucking cartoon wolf and, like, you know, picture these, like, tweens naked just because they're giggling and they have boobs.
It's like, snap, indeed.
He didn't really have boobs, though. Like, they kind of had boobs.
One of them had.
They had as much boobs as any normal skinny person would have without getting implants.
Both of them put together had one boob.
If you glued all the boobs, the conglomerated number of boobs, it's just a single boob.
It would make one giant uniboob.
Uniboob? Alright, so, very much open to interpretation, this movie.
I didn't like it, though.
I thought it was, I would give it a better rating than Funhouse, because I think it at least succeeded in doing what it was meant to
being original.
I mean, it was more definitely more original than Funhouse, right. But I think it succeeded at its goal. It was more successful at achieving its goal than Funhouse was. Funhouse should have had so many gory murders that you would be like cringing for days over, fucking legs chopped off and then crammed full of salt. That kind of shit sticks with you. Like, oh no, somebody got hung. Right. Whoops. Scooby-Doo. It was very much the Mystery Gang, like, feel.
Mystery Gang gets murdered.
Yeah.
Well, like, with Escape from Tomorrow, I watched that movie and completely felt like the director was just like, okay, I'm going for a Hitchcock feel here. Like, that was my number one feeling whenever I felt that, like, I don't know. Maybe it's just I've seen quite a few Hitchcock films. Maybe.
I think it's less of a this is exactly what I want to do, but on the surface, especially visually, you get that feeling, one, because it's in black and white,
right?
And many Hitchcock films were, and two, because, you know, it's sort of that mind fuck of a plot, like,
right.
Nothing to be directly explained. But that doesn't mean he was necessarily just trying to rip off, like, he wasn't just going for
maybe
that.
Maybe not rip off. I won't say rip off, because he did
or even an homage to him.
I would definitely say it was homage to him. Like, it was, and not only that,
it was an homage to that kind of storytelling,
sure. You could definitely tell
but many
that.
Many people make movies that are just supposed to be a continuous mindfuck that's like, what really happened? Like, did
but
this
just
happen?
The way that it was shot, the way that you saw the characters, you know. And I realized that it was shot on, like, minimal equipment, but the way that it was shot and edited just reminds me of a Hitchcock film. I mean, it is very, very most likely that he is directly influencing this movie.
I totally agree, and I think but I'm just saying, I wouldn't discount it. I wouldn't say this movie sucks because all it is just a crappy attempt to make a movie almost like Hitchcock would have made. I wouldn't discount it entirely just saying that, because I don't think that's the only value that it has.
Well, I kind
of
do, because the only value I really see in this movie is the ballsiness of it. The originality that he takes with it, it doesn't jump out at me. It's not like, I'm like, oh man, not only was it ballsy, but he really fucked up my mind and whatnot. I mean, it was strange, but it wasn't something that I'll ever say,
this is
oh,
level
yeah.
one strange.
Yeah, it wasn't something that is ever going to make me say, man, you gotta watch Escape from Tomorrow, because it's...
First do a lot of acid, and then watch Escape from Tomorrow, dude. It'll fuck your shit up. Well, no, watch fucking Scanner Darkly on acid instead.
Or like, just drunk.
Yeah, or it at all.
Just watch Eraserhead and forget about this movie.
I guess I just felt it was very underwhelming.
I totally fucking agree with that. Like, it was... It's worth
a more punk rock feeling. Well, at least I did.
Yeah, I agree. And it just, its value is too very closely tied to just how many technical, like, victories that they had. To me, I can't get over that. I can't just say this movie's a shitty ass attempt to do something whatever with a weak ass plot, because I can hold these extremely, like, I feel like these. The achievements that they made making this movie is really something.
Right.
Like, something to be, like, looked
into. Well, that's
into.
Because you're experienced with film a little
with
bit.
Making film, yeah.
And, which is understandable, but That's not the things that you see when you read the hype about this movie. You don't see things like, oh, the reason this movie's so good is because all the ridiculous technological stuff that they had to go through to get it done. It's all the stuff that's like, oh man, it's a mindfuck. But you're right whenever you said that people don't watch good movies anymore. People watch Battleship.
I was getting ready to say, like, you're talking about the same people that also said, oh, go right out and watch Paranormal Activity. It's such a revolutionary movie.
Even though Blair Witch came out, what, 15 years before that?
And it's pretty much the fucking same thing. Yeah. Only better.
Better, yeah. Agreed.
Slightly. To me, it's like, you can't just look at the hype and say, oh, I'm going to hold this movie to this hype standard because people think that shitty things are great all the time. Like, this is not a strange or unexpected thing to me anymore. If there's big hype about a movie, I just ignore it because you have to.
You have to make your own decisions on it. And I guess that's just my decision with this movie. Like,
it's hard to do.
I totally think it's ballsy, and I definitely respect them for the choice to go out and put basically their lives on the line as far as financially.
I mean, their futures are dependent on how Disney plans to handle this.
Not just financially, but
just everything.
But their careers too.
Yeah.
I mean, if this movie,
it's not as though you could sue somebody for future film rights, you could, though.
If technically you might be able to get somebody blacklisted.
Yeah. That's what I was going to say. Like, not only that, but if you fuck over Disney, I mean, it's like they go around and tell every other movie company out there, this is the people that fucked over Disney. You've screwed with them. You're never going to work with us again.
Right. I get that. But a lot of people would almost use that as a reason to work with them and be like, I fucking hate Disney. They're just a bunch of Jew-hating crazy people.
Jew-hating crazies.
that's just a thing. I don't really believe that. But I'm just saying, like, that's a perception of Disney from some people's points of view.
I've never been a fan of Disney, personally. I mean, not really. I can recognize when they do occasionally do some good stuff. But overall, it's just, I'm not in love with the product. So I really wanted this to be like, from a technical aspect, we're saying, hey, fuck the man.
Right.
If from a more artistic standpoint, they were also saying, hey, fuck the man.
You would have liked it a lot. So much better.
Yes, it would have.
But maybe they kind of are, though, with the whole Disney's controlling everything. That may be kind of one of their interpretations.
I mean, I would agree. I would definitely agree with that. I mean, why else shoot it at Disney World? Like, right. You're trying to say
it just
Disney
comes off
is the devil.
A little limp-wristed.
It's very... The message of it is a lot less stern than you would think coming from someone that does something as ballsy as shooting this movie.
Yeah.
It comes off very noodle-dicked.
Yeah.
Yes, very noodle-dicked. Exactly.
But some noodles are hard and stiff.
But
not this one.
Cooked noodle-dick, you should say.
Yeah.
Boiled
well,
noodle dick.
I think we can wrap things up with these two movies. You guys good with that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
I mean, I'm not going to necessarily not recommend this movie. I just would have wanted, like DeHart said, a stronger message, a more clear message that wasn't just completely mindfucked.
Well, we all went into this expecting more, I think.
Right. And just simply, and I know, once again, they're shooting on location in a place where they're not supposed to be, whatever. More fucking special effects. More real monsters, real things that are scary happening instead of just having, like, mostly naked women floating across, like, superimposed on an amusement park ride.
You know, they were
That's not shocking to me. It doesn't freak me out. Like, it should have been freaking, like, the movie was meant to freak me out. It should have actually accomplished that.
Well, you knew they were scared to that it was going to get shut down. I mean, they had it edited in fucking South Korea.
Yeah, well, I mean, like, they didn't have to, but that was his paranoia.
No, they did it because he was afraid.
Yeah, I know that, but I'm saying, like, there was no reason. What are they going to do? Track him down? It's ridiculous.
Okay, I'm pretty sure the reason they would have done that is, one, South Korea has a huge film scene,
right.
So there are professional people there. Two, it's in Asia, so you'll get it a lot cheaper, and there aren't unions.
Yeah. So you're saying they're huge in Asia, huh?
A third reason is maybe if somebody did find out about the movie, they would not be able to stop them from editing it because they're in another country and there's the whole extradition process and everything like that.
Right.
Possibly, yeah.
Whatever. The point is,
I didn't see
that
a
was
lot,
a bit of paranoia, I think.
I didn't see a whole lot that in this movie that couldn't be done on a home computer.
Right.
Yeah, I totally agree with that. And that's... one of the things I heard about this movie was all the special effects were done in post, but they're extremely impressive nonetheless. Given that they all had to be done in post, and everyone, you know, there was no... They didn't have any cool tricks that they could use. There was no motion capture that they could use there on scene to, like, have them interact with whatever monster it is. Like, that I was expecting, like, quasi-decent special effects instead of the only special effect in the movie is poor green screening, poor, like, digital video overlay, and, you know, molding the face of a creature that's already fucking...
He's speaking of the It's a Small World demons. That was, like, my favorite part of the movie, was seeing all the demon faces.
Really, after that ride, you get a lot less hallucinations.
It reminded me of that episode of The Simpsons where Lisa drank the It's a Small World water and just started hallucinating.
Exactly! I thought, when that part happened, I was like, aw, yeah, time to ramp up and have some crazy shit go down! Because I'm tired of this bitch, I can't wait till she gets killed!
Why did he just turn into Buzz from the Funhouse?
Well, just saying, I was so pumped for shit to start going down after that, and then it just took a direct route to Boring Town, follow around creepy little girls.
Yeah, I was wanting, like, Mickey's Murder Mania.
Yeah.
On for the cover, Super Nintendo.
Who's gonna cut your tits off?
Once again, we have a cover that is fully selling you a movie that does not exist.
Yeah, exactly.
You got a bloody claw of Mickey Mouse with his glove and everything, and it's
Mickey's
like
Murder Mania.
It's murder time. Like, it's murder time.
But there was no murder.
Steamroller Willie.
There was not one
the only
murder.
The only way that you could call murder is if you thought maybe he did get the cat flu from that chick spitting in his face, and it was biological warfare, like. When you spit in someone's face and you have AIDS.
That's or maybe he and you cut your tongue. Or maybe he decapitated a real human when they're in the Simon's lab underneath.
Oh, you mean the Siemens?
Well, no, it's called Simon. Oh, or Simon's.
You mean it was Siemens?
It looks very Siemens-y.
Speaking of Siemens, how about that tube of generic Neosporin?
Oh,
that he's
Geosporin.
Geosporin. That he just jizzes all over everything.
Yeah.
Which is obvious. I mean, that's not a slightly veiled attempt to show that he's just jizzing on everything. But there was like 200 gallons of Neosporin in that thing.
No, it was Geosporin.
You're
going to get sued.
Yeah, so I mean, good. Zyman's just as big, if not comparably
to
big.
Disney.
Yeah, they're almost as big.
And they could have also sued the tits off of their creators.
Yeah, and they didn't really try to hide them at all.
No. Not at all.
In fact, they literally had their logo right
out
front.
Put them in there.
Yeah.
I wonder why that is.
I don't know.
Well, I mean, they...
Maybe it was secretly funded by Simon's.
That would be fucking funny.
Yeah, it would.
That would make me like the movie a lot more. Like, these are things we might learn if we were to research the movie, which is, once again, something that I find... It's like an art house thing. Like, you have to understand the motivations of the people that created it in order to even approach liking the movie.
Right.
At least I think so. Like, anytime... Like, you walk up to a piece of artwork in a museum, and it's just a dot on a piece of paper, and you're like, this is fucking a dot on a piece of paper.
Right.
But it has meaning. It could have real value if you knew what it was supposed to mean.
Right.
I might not agree.
Well, I kind of think that some of those are just...
that is the point, DeHart. Like, some of them, the point of them is to be bullshit and then to be art because they're bullshit, because it's bullshit pretending to be art, that makes it art. Like,
yeah.
It's like a quadruple, like, backwards double backflip fuck. Like, it's a very squirrely, like, hard to grasp, like, hard to get a hold of. You can't pin it down, like, you know.
I'm familiar with several pieces of bullshit art, and it's like, I'm just not.
I'm familiar with the double backflip fuck.
Yeah. Well, Steven, I know you're familiar with the double backflip fuck. You rode the Roadrunner ride at Kentucky Kingdom, which you walked out of there basically crippled. I thought you were going to say that ride.
Oh, no. Well, that was scary, too.
We can wrap this up considering we're in our, like, 20th hour of podcasting.
Yeah. If you want to follow us on Twitter, you can follow us at MPM Podcast. You can find us on iTunes, where you can subscribe to our podcast, as well as download all our episodes for free. Don't forget to rate and review us. You can find us on Tumblr and YouTube, as well as stream all of our episodes for free on unitedcypher.com. Check out Five Finger Tees, as well as Empire Comics.
I still think Five Finger Tees sounds like some kind of really gross, like, fisting website. Like, you're such a Five Finger Tees. It's like...
But they're not a fisting website, Philip. They're a very awesome t-shirt website that sells very awesome and inexpensive shirts.
I understand that. I'm just trying to build their street cred, Steven.
Oh, okay. Check out some podcasts that we've been listening to, Return to Living Podcast. Also, check out Nerdonomy. They do a couple podcasts, Nerds on Film and Nerds on History. Check out Girls with Issues. And check out Unitedcypher Presents. Yeah. Stalk us on Facebook.
I find that I enjoy the podcasts that I listen to a lot more when I know who I'm listening to.
Yep. Yeah, you can find my personal Twitter is Rosie4Boston.
My personal Twitter is Radioactive Suit.
And DeHart doesn't have a personal Twitter because he doesn't believe in the internet.
Because DeHart was born in a world with no internet.
1952.
Why does he get older every time we do the podcast? It's so not nice and very unfair.
I'm one of your hosts, Stephen the Roast Rosenberg,
Phil the Kill Collins,
and DeHart.
And we'll see you next time. Damn.